Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In the previous two videos of this long playlist, I told you about monotone convergence theorem and dominated convergence theorem. I gave you like complete proofs of those two theorems. In this video, we are going to go a little bit further and I'm going to give you a counter example to those two theorems. So what I mean by counter example is, as usual, an example of, in this case, sequence of measurable functions that do not satisfy the assumption of those two theorems and such that the conclusion of the theorem does not hold. So just coming back to the statement of the theorem, so I quickly remind you that in the context of monotone or dominated convergence theorem, we have a sequence xn of measurable functions with pointwise limit x. And in the context of the monotone convergence theorem, we assume this first condition here, that the sequence is positive, so meaning that all the xn are positive, and that the sequence is non-decreasing. And in the context of the dominated convergence theorem, we assume that the sequence is dominated by an integrable function. So in both theorems, you can conclude that x is measurable. The slash in integrable refers to the dominated convergence theorem. In this case, you have better than measurable, it's integrable. And the main conclusion is that the limit of the integral is equal to the integral of the limit. So here, what we want to do, of course, is find a sequence xn of functions that are measurable with a pointwise limit x, but such that the sequence is not non-decreasing and such that the sequence is not dominated by an integrable function. And we need to find an example such that the conclusion limit of the integral equals to integral of the limit is not satisfied. So the way you do that, there is a very simple construction. In fact, we are going to do the following. So the framework we are going to use, like for this measure space omega fp, is pretty simple. We are just going to assume that omega is the set of real numbers equipped with the Borel sigma algebra, and the measure is just the Lebesgue measure. And so in fact, all the functions I'm going to define, they are not only Lebesgue measurable, they are also Riemann. They are not just Lebesgue integrable, sorry, they are also Riemann integrable, and everything goes fine. But that's going to show you a counterexample to those two theorems. So the idea is simple. You just take, so let's say the interval 0, 1 here. So I have 0 here, 1 here. And here I have the y axis. And I'm going to start by cutting this interval into two equal pieces. So you look at 1/2 here, and I'm going to look at here a value, so exactly between 1/2 and 1. And I'm going to look at this triangle function here. Okay, so that's just linear, piecewise linear. Then to simplify the calculation, I'm going to assume, so let me see, I'm going to assume that we have the value 4 here. So that's the first function. I'm going to call that one x1. And to define x2, you are going to do some kind of procedure that we are going to repeat again and again. You just divide again this interval 0, 1/2 into two equal pieces, so at 1/4. And the 1/4, 1/2 is going to become the support, what we call the support of the next function, so x2 here. But this function is going to go twice higher. So here we have 8, and we are going to have a peak here. Just in between here, you go at 8, and then you do this triangle like this. And you keep going like that. So I'm going to draw one more. So after it becomes, you understand, pretty complicated to draw both functions, because the basis here, the support, is divided by 2 at each step. and then you go twice higher. So very quickly, your function looks like really like a very, very high, narrow peak. But you understand the idea, and so here we have 1/8, we go up to 16, so double that. And then here we want to go up to here, and then let me try to draw that straight, we get something like this. And so on. So this is x3. So before we do any calculation, and before we prove that indeed this is a counterexample to those two theorems, monotone and dominated convergence theorem, let's check quickly that indeed this sequence of functions does not satisfy the assumption of the two theorems. So it's clear that their supports, you see, are disjoint. Okay? So because the supports are disjoint, clearly this means that the sequence is not non-decreasing. There is no monotonicity. So by that I mean that x1 is not less than x2. Okay? x1 is larger than x2 between 1/2 and 1, but x2 is larger than x1 between 1/4 and 1/2 and so on. So we don't have a monotonicity of the sequence. So now let's look at the condition of domination. So it's pretty easy to find the smallest possible function that dominates all those ones. That's because their supports are disjoint, the smallest possible function that dominates all of them is the sum of all those functions. So that's going to be the function equal to x1 between 1/2 and 1, x2 between 1/4 and 1/2, x3 between 1/8 and 1/4, and so on. And it turns out that it's easy to see that this function is not integrable. So the smallest function that dominates all those xn is in fact not integrable. So how do we see that? Well, you can easily find the integral of each of those functions. So here, we don't look at some weird abstract integral on some weird set. Those functions are defined on R, and we are using the Lebesgue measure. So that means that the integral of x1 is just the area under the graph, so that's going to be the area of this middle triangle. And so the area of this middle triangle is just the length here, which is 1/2, times 4, that gives you a 2, but divided by 2, because you look at a triangle, and so eventually you get a 1 here. Okay, the 1 is to show you the value of the integral. The integral of x1 d lambda with respect to the Lebesgue measure is 1. Integral of x2 is going to be, well, the length here now is twice less, it's 1/4, but the peak is at 8. So eventually you have 1/4 times 8, that gives you again a 2, divided by 2, that gives you again a 1. And you see that in general, for all xn, the integral of xn d lambda is equal to 1. So it's pretty easy to see. It's just that at each step, you divide by 2 the length here at the bottom, but you multiply by 2 the height. So overall, you don't change the area of those triangles. So you again have a 1 here, and so on. So what we just proved here is the fact that the integral of xn d lambda, so that's the same as the integral of xn of x dx if you think of the Riemann integral. Those functions are Riemann integrable. So this is going to be equal to 1 for all n. So because that's equal to 1 for all n, then the limit of this sequence of integrals is also equal to 1. So from that we deduce that the limit when n goes to infinity of the integral of xn d lambda is equal to 1. So that also tells you that this smallest possible function that dominates all of them, which is the sum of all of them because their supports are disjoint, is not integrable because you have some kind of sum of 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 infinitely many times. Okay, so indeed, not only the sequence is not monotone, but also the assumptions of the dominated convergence theorem, this condition of this assumption of domination is not satisfied. So, and we already have the limit of the integral. So now, the last step is to look at the integral of the limit. And most of the work is going to be to understand what is the limit. So, what can we say about the limit when n goes to infinity of xn? So clearly the support of both functions, so you just have to look at the support of both functions. So you see that the support is a subset always of R plus. So that means that xn of little x is equal to zero for all x negative, okay? Now, if you take an x strictly positive, so maybe let me do a zoom of that. So you have a zero here, and let's take x strictly positive, even very, very, very small. So I'm going to do it here, but so I'm looking at what happens here. Basically, I'm looking at a zoom of this region. Even if you take x very, very, very small, because x is strictly positive, you can find, so you see those numbers are, like here you have a 1 half at the power 1, 1 half at the power 2, 1 half at the power 3 and so on. So the left point here is of the form 1 half at the power n. So for n sufficiently large, your 1 half at the power n is going to be less than x. So you have it here, for instance, so 1 half at the power n. And then that means that after this n, okay, xn plus 1 is going to be to have its support on the left of x, okay? So that means that xn plus 1 of little x is going to be equal to 0, and same for the next one, xn plus 2 and so on. So that means that for all x strictly negative, xn of little x is 0. Eventually, the limit is 0. For all x strictly positive, xn of little x is going to also converge to 0. Now, the only value missing is 0 itself. But you see that for all n, xn of 0 is equal to 0. So that means that, again, if we look at the pointwise limit here, so that means that, again, limit when n goes to infinity of xn of 0 is 0. So eventually, this little reasoning shows that this sequence of functions is, even if you don't have monotonicity, you still have pointwise convergence, but the limit is equal to zero, okay? So that's zero everywhere, and clearly the integral of the function which is equal to zero is equal to zero. And so from that, we conclude that the integral of the limit when n goes to infinity of xn, d lambda is equal to zero. And you see that, so here we had the limit when n goes to infinity of the integral of xn, that's 1. But if you exchange limit and integral, and you look at the integral of the limit of those xn, with respect again to the Lebesgue measure, you get 0. So that gives you indeed a counterexample. So that's an example of a sequence of measurable functions. Such that the limit of the integral is not equal to the integral of the limit. And so that shows that, in fact, the condition of monotonicity in the monotone convergence theorem and the assumption of domination in the dominated convergence theorem are both important conditions.